And now hear the reading of the Word of God, one of the most incredible passages in the Gospel of Luke. The angel Gabriel's appearance to Mary and the announcement that she is to be the mother of the Son of God. Luke 1, 26 to 38. Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting it was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I have not known a man?" And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also that Holy One who is to be born in you will be called the Son of God." Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. Then Mary said, "Behold, the maid servant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. The word of God. O Lord, bless now the understanding of this magnificent encounter that has so much to say about how we receive power and strength this Christmas and how we begin the new year. Lord, help us. In your holy name, amen. A couple of years ago, Harry Reasoner, the news commentator, ended a broadcast at Christmas time in a most remarkable way. After he had described some of the customs of Christmas, he looked into the camera and said, "It's beyond logic. It is either the most false thing in the world or the truest thing in the world. It's the account of God who in his innocence became a baby, who became a man. And the shock upon the heart of that fact is so great that if it is not true, then nothing else is true. So this Christmas, if Christians are touched, it's worth it. And who knows? Perhaps the touch will take." Pretty remarkable word from a secular broadcaster. And my question to you is, have you had the touch that takes? Or, to go much deeper, have you had the transforming experience of the true meaning of Christmas? Christmas is the celebration of the birth of the risen Savior. We would not have had Christmas any year if it were not for the fact that Christ rose from the dead, that he returned in his power and baptized the disciples with the power of the Holy Spirit. Without the vindication of the resurrection, the empty tomb, and the outpouring of the power of the Spirit, we would not celebrate Christmas. And yet the question is, have you had the touch that takes? Has what Christmas is all about really happened to you? The greatest danger is that we can go through Christmas and leave the most important aspect of it unwrapped. And I want to talk to you now about the most stupendous, most awesome, most shocking truth that could ever be realized. You've heard it so often that your mind is dull to it. You have what I call faithless familiarity. And in some way, I pray that God will give me the gift to impress you again with the awesome wonder of it. In the story of the conception and the birth of Jesus, we have a progression that is applicable to your life and mine. Mary knew awe, amazement, and then adoration. And the way the angel Gabriel dealt with her and her response is exactly what happens to you and me when we experience the true meaning of Christmas that lasts all through the year, lasts the rest of our lives, and assures us that we will live forever. And the angel came to Mary. She was filled with awe. The very presence of the angel with the brightness of his glory was stunning enough. And then she listened to what he had to say. You see, at this time, she was betrothed, but not married. She had been promised by the matchmaker to Joseph. And then, in the final year just before the marriage, they lived, but not as husband and wife. And she could not believe that the angel told her that she was to be the mother of the Son of God, that in her womb would be a conception by the power of the Holy Spirit. And then the growth of the fetus, and finally the birth of the one to be called Jesus, for he would save his people from their sins. Amazement resulted, and little wonder. She said, "I've never known a man. How can this be?" And then Gabriel told her, she would be overshadowed by the power of the Holy Spirit, and the miraculous birth would take place. Don't allow it to slip by you. None other than the living Word of God, proclaimed by John, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. There was nothing made that was made except by the Word of God." The very creative dynamic of the power of God, the verve of God, the verb of God. His Word, the Son of God, in the bosom of the Father, none other than the Son of God, was to come in an act of awesome humility and be born among us. I like the way John puts it in his prologue in the 18th verse. No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son in the bosom of the Father, he has made him known. Oh, but look at the ancient manuscripts in the Greek. And it's monogenes theos, not monogenes huios. Let me read it again. No one has seen God at any time. the only begotten God, Theos, who was in the bosom of the Father, he has made him known. Don't miss it. In the wondrous relationship between Father and Son, a decision was made for the Son to come, that we might have the same relationship with the Father that his eternal Son has enjoyed way beyond in eternity, before the beginning of time and space. This becomes even more awesome when we realize that the same progression in which Jesus was conceived, grew, and was born is the way you and I come into the dynamic power of the Christian life. The promise that is made to you and to me is that in our minds and hearts, in the totality of our being, a conception can take place. The living Christ can begin to grow. And we can become possessed and filled and empowered by him. Now, you've heard enough of that to make you faithlessly familiar with it. So you didn't really hear what I said. Let me say it again. The eternal Word of God, the creative dynamic of God, the Son of God, who lived in the womb of Mary, born in Bethlehem, laid in a stinking old manger out of which cows fed, who lived among us, walked with us, taught us about the reality of God and what we could become, died on the cross for us, burst out of that tomb, lives forever. That one who poured out the Spirit at Pentecost, the same one, the only begotten God. He's the one who comes to us and says, I have created you to be my dwelling place. Is there any room in the inn? And often there isn't, so crowded. Catch the sheer wonder of it. In that ninth verse of the eighth chapter of 2 Corinthians, you know the grace of the Lord Jesus. That though he was rich, yet for our sakes became poor, that through his poverty we might become rich. That's the secret, isn't it? And what is the richness? The indwelling Christ. Being a Christian isn't just trying to follow Christ, live up to the message of Christ, follow the dictates of Christ. The Christian life is a life filled with him, empowered by him, enabled by him, gifted by him. And if you haven't experienced that, you haven't had the touch that takes. Don't you see? You and I have been created to know that same blend of the dynamic power of the divine and the humble capacity of the human to be blended perfectly together in our own being, just as the divine dwelt in Jesus of Nazareth. And there was a perfect union, a hypostatic union of the divine and the human. So too now, when we receive Christ, we become the same wondrous manifestation of the grace of the Lord. That's the touch that takes, that lasts forever. It's the mystery. In the New Testament, the word mystery, mysterion, is not some hidden esoteric fact. It's an open secret. The mystery is now clear. We know what God is like. We know what life was meant to be. We know that our sins are forgiven through Calvary. We know that death has been defeated. We know we are alive forever. We know where we're going to spend eternity. And now, in the meantime, we become the post-resurrection home of the living Christ. Don't leave him in a manger, in a feeding trough. Behold him on a cross. See him bursting out of that tomb. See him reigning over history as Lord of lords and King of kings. And give him your life. That's the gift that cannot, must not be left unwrapped. How silently the wondrous gift is given, and God imparts to human hearts the glories of his heaven. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him. Listen. The dear Christ enters in.